I'm Karen.
I'm Shelley.
And
we're Alisha's Attic.
Alisha's Attic were an English pop duo of the 90s and early 2000s. The two sisters, Karen and Shelley Poole, would captivate audiences. With their blend of quirky and alternative pop. Let's discover the hidden treasures in Alisha's Attic. Karen Poole was born in London in January 1971, with sister Shelley arriving a year later in March 1972. They are the daughters of 1960s vocalist Brian Poole, lead singer of The Tremolos, an English beat group founded in 1958, who had big success in the UK with hits such as Do You Love Me? Wishing to follow in their father's musical footsteps, Karen and Shelley would come together as a duo, working alongside Terence Martin and releasing their first single, Sugar Daddy, as Karen and Shell in 1988, but it would fail to chart.
And we didn't really know what we wanted to do, so we went down a kind of very pop angle of singing. There was a guy who wrote So Macho back in the day. I don't know if you remember that song.
I know the song, yes.
But basically, he wrote a song for us called Sugar Daddy.
Oh.
Yeah. And so we sang his song.
Okay.
And I think that kind of, that was my first moment of like, okay, I'm not doing this. We have to write our own songs.
But tonight we stick to what popular music has always been about, affairs of the heart. Here are Karen and Shell and Lavender Blue.
You know, I always really wanted to be a dancer rather than a singer, but I kind of just got carried away with the singing just because Shelley really, really loved singing. And then I actually, rather than learn to sing, I learned to sing harmony more than I learned to sing. Because Shelley was just so good, I was just like, okay, well, I'm going to have to sort of fluff around that a bit.
Later singles would struggle to gain much traction, and the pair would retire their squeaky pop sound in favour of something a little less saccharine.
In a way, doing that made me think, actually, no, I'm not going to do that. We need to think about how we want to be seen. And then I started to really, and Shelley, we really started to think about more about where we actually wanted to be, how we wanted to be seen, what message we wanted to give across. We didn't want to sound normal. We wanted it to be really interesting. And we were getting into things. Obviously, Prince was a massive influence. Alanis Morissette then was massive with that album. We were listening to that like crazy. So those kind of influences obviously were massive to us. So yeah, we just wanted to just do something that was a bit off the wall, really, like nobody else was doing.
It was kind of like we knew we were going to make an album. We'd sent off loads of tapes, cassette tapes.
Oh my God.
I know, to record labels. We'd been turned down by all of them. And we used to watch Top of the Pops and go, oh, they're rubbish. Oh, they're terrible. And we just kept going. We persevered. And eventually sent the right tape to the right person at the right time. Got a reply. And he was like, come in and see us. And from that point on, we had lots of offers.
But it took a long time to get to the point where we'd found a record deal, because we were sort of writing in our attic for about 8 years. We've got a studio in our attic where we do all our demos and writing. And so it just took a hell of a long time to get to the position we're in now and get the songs right and the music.
But a lot of it was really tragic that we did, you know. I mean,
tragic nonsense.
8 years of tragic crap.
Poo.
To get where we
poop.
Got a record deal.
Mm-hmm.
And they went, oh, we like that tragic crap, we like them.
Sucker. What kind of bands and stuff were you in before this?
Just pub bands, you know, really horrible,
doing covers,
crappy,
or stuff?
Tragic
no.
stuff. Not covers, it used to be people who'd written songs and were getting a gig for like 20 quid, do you want to come down and sing backing vocals? Yeah, right there for 20
nice.
Quid.
Down a local pub, yeah, we'd be there again.
Down the Cauliflower in Dagenham.
Yeah, that was about it.
And how do you find working together, being sisters?
It's fab, actually.
Does everyone ask that as well?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, but it's no, it's really cool, actually. I mean, we get on really well, apart from we live together.
Oh,
she
dear.
Never cleans the bath.
No,
she leaves a red rim of scum.
Oh, is that from the dew?
Yeah, from the dew.
It's from
the dew.
Yeah. So you get on,
we get on. Yeah, I mean, musically we get on really well, but, you know.
We probably bicker. We don't ever fight. We just have little sort of bickers. Right? Yeah.
I mean, the story of us getting together with our label, Mercury, is quite a long one, because it was weirdly through our lawyer, a guy called David Glick, who we met. And I basically said to the lawyer, look, we don't have any money, but if anything comes up, we would obviously pay you if we get a record deal, kind of thing. And he just liked us, and he just introduced us to a few people. One of the guys was a guy called Mark Fox. You know Mark Fox?
I know Mark.
Who is a lovely guy. And he helped us and put us in touch with Howard Berman, among other people. And then, of course, once... You know how it was in those days, where if one person hears something, then suddenly it becomes a bit of a thing, and you know, you've got five A&R people knocking on your door rather than none, you know. So it was just a real, it suddenly became a bit of a rat race to get to sign us. And we signed with Howard, who's amazing. We still speak to Howard these days, and he's just such a lovely guy. And it was him who suggested this, right? Obviously, these demos are not great, so we need to get a producer on board. And we were like, well, we don't really want somebody to just like take them and do their thing. And he said, let's go and meet some people. And we met some really great producers, brilliant people. And then we met Dave Stewart in his flat, his penthouse flat in Covent Garden. And I just remember going in, and he was just so weird. We were just sold straight away. He was like, right, okay, go and put that lampshade on your head over there, and you sit in the bath, and I'm going to take some pictures. It was that kind of thing. We were like, okay. And we absolutely loved it. We were like, yeah, we are in with this guy, you know. And that's how it all started. We started really quickly, went into the church in Crouch End, which was Dave and Annie's studio at the time. And pretty much recorded the whole album there. We did some of the stuff at his house in France. We weren't like super involved musically, but we would say like, oh no, that we don't really like the sound of that, or we don't really like. And also, we put the vocals down really early. We wouldn't be like a full track. We would put the vocals down to something really basic, and then they would build the track around the vocals. And I think that really, really, really helped.
We both take adopted roles. Like, my role is much more passive in the studio than Karen's, and yet when it comes to actually singing and performing, I'm much more dominant than Karen. But in the writing side of it, Karen's a lot more bossy, and we're like that in real life too.
I normally come up with the lyrics, and
that's when we actually start arguing at that point.
Yeah, it's like we can sit, you know, like sometimes I'll sit there and I'll write, you know, like what I think is a brilliant song, the whole thing, then I'll go to Shell and I'll go, right, this is the song, this is how it's going to be. You know, because I am a control freak. And Shell goes, oh no, I don't like that. You can't repeat that twice. That's awful. You've got to do it like this. You put this word in, I don't like that. Don't like. And that's where we're like...
I remember sort of sitting with Karen about I Am, I Feel in my front room in Dagenham. She's like, what do you think? It goes, and I am, I feel. And I'm like, I really like that, but that should be the chorus. She's like, oh, don't be ridiculous. She stormed out. Don't be so bloody
ridiculous.
Because
I'd only written a verse and a bridge, and I was like, I really like this verse and bridge, and it goes, and this is the bridge, and then we're going to go into a huge big chorus shell. And she was like, but you should repeat that again for the chorus. And I'm like, no way, no way.
And then she come back about an hour later, because she lived 2 doors away from me, knocking on the door, okay then.
Can't think of anything better.
The name Anesthetic actually comes from the fact that we transformed our attic into a little studio, a demo studio, where we do all our demos, and we still do actually. We're doing, we create everything up there. So we wanted it to be called something attic, and we didn't know what name to use. And we started writing a song called Alisha Rules the World. And Shelley used to have an imaginary friend when she was little, so we named it after, we named Alisha after Shelley's imaginary friend.
She's really a character in the song now, and she's a sort of split personality type of girl. And you're not quite sure. She's very deceptive. The way she looks and the way she actually treats people is two different things. She's a pretty cool cookie.
And she appears in a little bit of a comic strip in the CDs. Like, do you reckon she'll be having a future as a constant comic character or something?
I don't think so. I think it was good fun for the first one, but that's like all the adventures that we can't have in real life.
So done it vicariously.
But they've drawn us really nice because they've given me really big boobs and like, big lips and stuff.
I found out and said, can you make my cleavage fit?
Well, we can't talk about that here though. So you're into recording in weird places. The attic, I understand, was like your attic where you're recording for a while.
Yeah, it still is. We do all our songs down there.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And what about the church?
The church is Dave Stewart from Rhythmic Studios, and that's where we did the album in about 4 weeks from start to finish. In a church, an actual church. Half of it's a church and half of it's a studio in a church.
Very spiritual. Did you hang out there a lot then?
Yeah, we did. Well, what we did was we built a video set for our video in the church studios in the acoustic hall. So yeah, we ended up doing everything in there actually. It was like a council flat and it was like our flat in the church.
Yeah.
And it was like, I don't know, but we did some illegal things. Mad.
Don't say you did some illegal things. I Am, I Feel is the first single off this. And you probably all know that.
The duo's debut single, I Am, I Feel, would be released on the 15th of July 1996. It was written by Karen and Shelley and produced by Dave Stewart of The Arrhythmics. The single quickly became a radio and chart hit in the UK, entering at number 15 on the UK singles chart, then peaking at number 14 the following week. In France, the track entered the charts at number 40, but was more successful in Sweden, where it peaked at number 23. Outside Europe, it peaked at number 18 in Australia. I wanna bite his head off, yeah, that'd be fun. Cause I sure got an appetite. I Am, I Feel was nominated in the category Best Song Musically and Lyrically at the 1997 Ivor Novello Awards.
Your halo ain't fitted that good for a little while now. You ain't got that certain glow that I get a kick out of. I like it more than me. I'm taking it on the chin with a grin, but my feet are itching and itching. He says, don't cry my precious one, cause I ain't got no sympathy for you. And I am, I feel like I wanna smash his face in. That'd be fun, cause I sure got a fist for a fight. I clicked my heels together 3 times, they sparked a little but nothing happened. And the big bad wolf's still in my bed. I am, I feel, sometimes think that you forget that I am, I feel, that I got to get away.
Alisha Rules the World would follow as the second single on the 21st of October 1996. The song would better the chart position of their debut, peaking in the UK at number 12.
Oh,
Following two top 20 hits, their record label Mercury would release the debut album Alisha Rules the World on the 4th of November 1996. The album was produced by Dave Stewart and would peak at number 14 in the UK and reach number 29 in Scotland. The album received positive reviews, with The Guardian awarding it 4 stars, and would go platinum the following year, selling 400,000 copies in the UK, with another 100,000 in Japan.
Who are you influenced by?
We're influenced by lots of different people. I mean, you know, Shel really likes people like Jimi Hendrix and The Doors, but, you know, we love Prince, Wendy and Lisa, Kate Bush.
Kate Bush!
Kate Bush!
Really?
Madam Bush.
Oh, you like Kate Bush so much. Oh,
yeah.
Kate Bush.
No.
How come you like Kate Bush?
How come you like her?
Oh, she's magnificent. She's the one. Yeah. She performs. She's theatrical.
She's visual, isn't she? She's fab doing
she
all that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Shel does a great impression of Brooklyn Heights.
I have to be drunk.
Oh, right.
Alisha's Attic would be nominated for a 1997 Brit Award for Best Newcomer, but would miss out, with the award going to Kula Shaker.
Kula Shaker!
Indestructible was pushed as the next single from the album, released on the 3rd of March 1997. The song would match the peak of previous single Alisha Rules the World, charting at number 12 in the UK.
The world. The fantastic debut album from Alisha's Attic, including their 3 massive hit singles, Indestructible, I Am I Feel, and Alisha Rules the World. And the beautiful new single, The Air We Breathe. Alisha Rules the World, the stunning debut album from Alisha's Attic, out now.
The final single lifted from the album would be Air We Breathe, released on the 30th of June 1997. The song was an alternative version to that which featured on the album. Yet again, the single would peak in the UK at number 12.
The galaxy is open, and so paint me on your right hand, then let's fly. Be so good, I'll never look back. With every breath I take, my thoughts say I want you, and there's nothing I can do to control these natural instincts. If you're ready, we can take it.
In July 1997, the band played at the first Lilith Fair Festival. They also toured with INXS and supported Jon Bon Jovi, as well as their own headline tours throughout the late 90s.
And the air we breathe will take us.
album was done, you mean?
Yeah, when, what was the moment when you knew, okay, we've got to get back in, we do another record?
Oh my god, we'd already done, like, we were well excited because we'd, you know, this was our job. We didn't muck about, we weren't sort of put together and quick, we need another album. We'd got, we had like 100 songs in a bag going, we need a home. So we'd just go and get, you know, the songs that we loved and we couldn't find a home for, they didn't fit together, and we'd rework them and go, oh, that'd be good, this would be good, you know.
So you were just writing the whole time?
Oh, the whole time, yeah. Yeah, no, that wasn't a pressure. That was more like, a, oh, thank God we get home for some of these, this work we've done. Yeah, the second album was good.
On the second album, we chose a guy called Mark Platty, who is amazing. And actually, I'm really proud of the second record. But, you know, it was a departure. It was something that we wanted to do because we wanted to be seen as people who totally, you know, organically came up with our own music and wrote our own music. Because I think throughout the promotion of the first record, there was a lot of Dave Stewart chat, you know. We tried to keep it as insular as it was on the first one. We didn't write with anybody new. And we kept it really, really insular as it was.
It's just the little things, the incidentals, it's like you wouldn't.
So we went to record the album without the incidentals, and then we sent that song back. Karen and I were in a hotel room with her boyfriend at the time, Jimmy Hogarth. We were sitting in the hotel room, wrote that song, and then sent it back to Howard Berman, our MD, and just said, actually, we really like this one. Do you mind if we stick this on and we probably record this one as well? And he was like, that's it, I love it, that's the hit.
Thought that it'll always be as wild as I expected to be, yeah.
On the 7th of September 1998, The Incidentals was released as the lead single from the band's upcoming second studio album. Still unable to break the UK top 10, the song would remain faithful to previous chart positions for the duo and peak at number 13 in the UK. Alisha's Attic's second album, Illumina, was released on the 5th of October 1998, produced by Mark Platty and Dave Stewart. It would peak at number 15 on the UK album chart. Follow-up single, Wish I Were You, was released at the end of the year on the 28th of December 1998. The song would be less successful than previous singles, charting outside of the UK top 20, peaking at number 29.
Yes, I do. I wish I were you. 70s attire, you know the whole planet, and the whole planet knows you back. You flaunt your imperfections, you carry it off.
Back, back. Do you feel safe with the woman
final single, Barbarella, would miss the top 30 in the UK, peaking at number 34 in April 1999.
Everybody thinks we're getting wiser, cause we're seeing three-dimensional, and we're filling up wide open space. Interactive, the word of the moment, lost the old gentleman in the face. A generation we can never replace, never, never replace. Do you remember the glamour on Sunset Boulevard?
The second album was not difficult. Actually, it was quite difficult. I don't know, I'm fibbing. It was quite difficult. We were both slightly separating in our musical directions by that point.
Okay.
And there was not friction with us as people, but friction in the writing process. And it was always supposed to be fun, and it's always supposed to be... I don't believe in the creative process. You're ever supposed to be really hurting or, you know... It's not supposed to be like that. I love a bit of frustration. I love a bit of, you know, there's a think place you go to, but it should never be not fun. And there were kind of times when it wasn't fun.
Okay.
And so when the third album came about, we wanted to write in a different way. So we hired our friends. It was John Entwistle, actually. You know John Entwistle from The Who? The bass player from The Who?
Oh, yeah.
We hired his mum's cottage, and we set up down his mum's cottage. We wanted it to be much more raw. We wanted all the instrumentation to be all live. So we set up in his mum's cottage. We set a drum kit up under the stair in the hallway, you know, by the stairs. And we wrote it at her house in the country. And I loved doing that, but... I mean, we were just, you know, we'd done so many live shows by then, we wanted it to be more live sounding, and I, you know, maybe that's too radical for people.
But again, it was just, it was much more organic process, actually. We were playing, Bill was really one for, like, just plugging stuff in and playing and trying to get a live kind of feel, like we were all jamming in the room, and sometimes a lot of the vocals would stay from that, and we'd just then overdub stuff. So it was something we'd really never done before, but I look back on those records, I absolutely love them. There's song called Pretender Got My Heart that's like one of my absolute faves, and it was just so organic. It you can hear the difference of how we were, I guess, how we were recording and also how we were writing, you know. It's just by that time there were much more emotional songs as well.
We actually had never had any intention of making a third record, really. You know, we were ready to sit and write pop songs for pop bands and do that whole thing of not particularly making it real for us anymore, because we didn't think the public really wanted to hear anything real, because the charts were so uninspiring, you know. So we just started sitting in our attic and writing tunes, and they just came out of nowhere, but they came from somewhere different, I think. It just came from a real sort of, you know, we were totally inspired by old 60s music and, you know, like Dusty Springfield, you know, listening to Dusty in Memphis or whatever. It was just totally like, God, she's got it so right, you know. So we switched off everything that was anything to do with now. And we just sat there and we sort of like had a good time and found that we could actually do it and have a good time together, and, you know.
And the joy came back to writing and to being in the studio together, whereas before we weren't having any joy at all. The joy actually came back to it, and we were like, oh, we've written such a great song, it's a classic. Everything to do with when you're trying to write and create something, the surroundings have to be different every time, otherwise it gets staid and bored. And
we got off the plane, we drove 3 hours north up on this little like windy road in the middle of nowhere, and we ended up in the middle of nowhere in this little log cabin, literally. And you know, we met this guy that Bill Betrayal, and we produced the album, and it just went from there. You know, we were totally closed off, and it was like, it's a great feeling of not being, you know, near anything, and no pressure, nobody turning around and saying, you should do it like this, or you should look like this, or you should do it, you know. We were like, it's laid back, we're going off.
Yeah.
All you had to do was concentrate on the music, and that's why everybody who lives up there is like painters and all sort of mad creative people, because there's nothing else to do. So it's really good. It's, you just channel everything into the, into that project, and we just for 2 months just completely got into it, didn't we? It was brilliant.
Is the title track of the album, and it's a really sweet song about, you know, your home life falling apart, and everything you built up with your partner has suddenly gone to nothing, and it's really sad and melancholy, but it's so organic and beautiful at the same time. It makes me cry. Now I feel all lost, I got no home, I feel all alone in the house that we built. No bricks, it's got no stones. You took all the love out of the house that we built. No guts, it's got no bones. I feel so alone in the house that we built. The album title came from the song House That We Built, which was we actually wrote when we were in America, which was one of the last ones we wrote, wasn't it? And then it just sort of all fell into place, you know. Consciously thinking about the house that we built when we were sort of writing it, I thought, well, that'd be a great album title, and it'll tie in, you know, sort of subconsciously thinking that. But that's where it came from, just from the song, really. We've had to completely, like, lay the foundations again and, you know, do the whole thing from start. You know, it's not been sort of like just, oh yeah, let's, you know, polish it up a bit. I mean, we've literally bashed it all down and stuck it all back up again.
That's fucking great.
A lot of hard work.
Sex is on everyone's tongue.
Sex on Everyone's Tongue was one of the... It was actually written while we were away on a writing trip. We went to the country and we saw trees and nice things, and Sex on Everyone's Tongue was one of those. It just came out really quickly. It's like a little ditty. It means, you know, it's not a proper song, really. There's no form to it. There's no chorus, but it works perfectly.
Everybody wants to get a quick hit, a quick fix, and that's just what's going on.
Because a lot of the songs were all about love and stuff, we just wanted to write something quite tongue-in-cheek about, you know, the sort of casualness of just writing that kind of song, and all what, you know, how funny it is about, you know, people just, you know, having one night stands with someone and all that kind of stuff, you know, from that angle. And just wanted to come up with a title first, and we did, and it was quite easy to write. It came really, really quickly. About when we recorded the record was that we were part of a team, you know. Actually making the record was very much, you know, a gang of people sitting around and recreating what we'd done in the attic or in the warehouse, you know. So it was a great feeling of being part of a team, and live work is definitely another thing where you know, we're not completely in control, you know. We let the musicians have a you know, a big part of it, because it is, you know. It shouldn't be about me and Shelley stuck at the front and our band at the back all in black t-shirts, you know, because that's naff, you know. We really want to be part of something that, so our vibe when we play to people is like about us, you know, all of us on stage and having a good time. When you're touring and you're with your members of your band and you're this lovely little team, I just think there's nothing more fulfilling than actually seeing people singing your songs as well. Because you don't see that when you're in the studio. You're just you, and you're just, you know, in that little tight thing. But when you're out there and actually seeing who buys your records, I mean, it's a strange array of people. It's actually good to see who's, you know, who's getting you and who likes you. The people that actually are our sort of loyal fans are so lovely. We always say that, don't we? We've been really lucky, like we've...
Yeah.
I think we might actually change our audience quite a bit with this record, though. I mean, I think people that listen to the first album and the second album may... I don't know if they'll be put off, but they'll definitely be like, wow, that's really different, because it is really quite a sort of totally different step for us to take, you know. But that's good. I mean, if we'd have just made an album that was just the same old, everyone would be bored, and we'd be bored, more than, you know, more importantly. So, I mean, it is quite a sort of jump, you know, and people would be like, ooh.
The whole album is so organic, and so it's all just, you know, walking around the studio and finding something to make a noise with. It's all... the way it should be. It's the way music should sound. There's no labour to it. It was just so easy to mic everything up and, you know, make noise and make it sound incredible, which is this stuff that's polished and all shiny today. Just you lose the vibe and you lose the rawness and the real, you know, passion behind it. And this album's got all of that, and we're so proud of it.
I've had with swimming, my feet get too wet.
Pilot just reminds me of just going off like that a bit. You know, it was the first song actually that we wrote on the album, and really simple chords, really simple, and wanted to be a bit clever with the lyrics. You know, wanted to do something a bit different, and I just think it works. You know, it sounds so dramatic. By Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and the words all say the same thing. You're trying to find ways to get out, and there's all these things you're trying to, you know, you've tried walking, you've tried taking locomotives, and you've tried steam engines, and you're still there. And I love it. The strings are so dramatic as well. When I listen to it, it almost feels like it should be a James Bond theme tune.
We actually know we've made a brilliant record because our friends are telling us we've made a brilliant record. The people that, you know, that we really admire and respect are telling us we've made a great record, and we know we've written a brilliant record, you know. So it feels so comforting. It's like that, you know, like when we say we want to be in a fishbowl, it's like we're in this brilliant little thing, and, you know, we've done it all ourselves, sort of thing.
The critically acclaimed album The House We Built, a mostly live album recorded with producer Bill Bottrell in Mendocino, USA, would ultimately become the band's final record, the lead track being Push It All Aside, released on the 12th of March 2001. The track would miss the UK Top 20, peaking at number 24.
We have got to know for a relationship in heaven. We've got to tame the devils on our tongue. Gonna fix us and put us back together again. So let's push it all aside, take a swallow of pride, and realize that nothing could be sweeter than loving each other. If we forget who is wrong and who's right, yeah, let's push it all aside, take a swallow of pride, and realize that nothing could be sweeter than loving each other. If we forget who is wrong.
It's probably one of my favourites because it's just got that European feel to it, and when we did first record it, it freaked me out a bit that it was very sort of, you know, we made it like with the zither and everything, it was all a bit sort of, it got a bit too Fiddler on the Roof for me, and I freaked out for a short while there, but now I'm just so into it, and I love the fact that it's all a bit gypsy, and it's really emotional, you know. I love the emotion in it, it's amazing.
And now all I have is my
always be
been totally inspired by like old Fellini films, and when we met Sophie Muller, the girl that directed it, you know, she totally had the same influences as us, didn't she? She was just really sort of on the same wavelength, and we just always wanted to do something that was like old. We didn't want to do anything in vogue, we didn't want to do anything trendy, anything, you know, that puts us in the mould with everyone else. We wanted to do a video that looked classic and different, and, you know, something that actually pushed people's buttons a bit to show that it's not normal, you know, it's not what everyone else is doing.
When we filmed Pretend I Got My Heart, we went to Spain to do it, and to find a video that matched the sort of grandness of the song Pretend I Got My Heart was really difficult. Yeah. So the only way we could have done that was to make a mini movie, and all the time we're like, it's okay, it's only a pop video, and we're like, nope, we are making a mini movie,
and we're waiting for our Oscars right now as we speak.
Pretender Got My Heart was the final ever Alisha's Attic single, released on the 16th of July 2001, and would sadly only chart at number 43 in the UK.
Love was a game, and you won too fast. Yeah, love was a painkiller that never lasts, and I hate to say that I won't care for it no more. Yeah, it was real to start, but I pretend I got my heart.
Their third album, The House We Built, would follow on the 23rd of July, but became their least successful album on the UK chart, peaking at number 55. Alisha's Attic, The Collection, would be issued in 2003, and the sisters would go their separate ways musically in 2004.
We got dropped by our record company, you know, there was that horrible moment when your manager rings you and says, right, you're dropped, and you're like, yeah. Oh my God, what am I going to do? But, you know, Shelley, I think, wanted to carry on a little bit more than I did, you know, and I think at that point I was just like, actually, I feel like almost, I think an artist sometimes gets to the point where it's not like they're running out of ideas. We definitely weren't running out of ideas, but I felt like our name was tired almost, you know, and like you get to that point where people are just a bit tired of that. And I felt like people were a bit like that with us, and I just thought, I think we just need to refresh somehow and just take some time out.
I'm trying to think of the actual finish. I think it was a very we'd done four albums, so we did the three, and then the Japanese album came at the end as well. So we'd done the Japanese album, and by the time that had come out, they said our contract was going to finish in the June, and Karen said, in June, do you want to, should we do another album? Should we write another album? Or should we just call it a day? And we were like, let's call it a day. We've done enough. We've done. So it was, and it was painful, I think. And do you know what? I don't know if it was. I think we were both done. Like, if I'm very honest about it, I think we were done with that side of music, you know, with that part of music. Because Karen had already had some ideas that she, you know, she was writing for other people at the time as well. Even when this last Japanese album was coming out, I'd been writing for other people too. I'd been writing a solo thing that I wanted to do as well. I'd been writing with lots of other people. So had Karen. And we were like, you know, maybe this has done, maybe it's done. And it was, you know, we'd done all we wanted to do with that particular thing. And it was fun and it was brilliant. And, you know, we could harmonise together so brilliantly, and it's just so nice to have your sister with you. But there is a time when you go, in this musical, guys, we've fulfilled our criteria.
Shelley would go on to achieve success writing and producing songs for other artists, including Janet Jackson, another notch on your bedpost, Ward Thomas, I could have told you, you were lying. Melanie C, Westlife, and many more. Her solo album, Hard Time for the Dreamer, was released in September 2005.
Nobody knows my name. Nobody knows
totally
my name.
Totally underwater.
I'm going deep up today.
Totally underwater.
Come show me how to feel it.
She co-wrote and sang on Michael Gray's dance release of 2006, Borderline, which reached number 12 on the UK singles chart.
Quiet out, waiting for the sign. Cause you're a risk and I'm borderline. And I kinda get.
In late 2008, Shelley formed the alternative country band Red Sky July with her husband Ali McErlane, the lead guitarist from Scottish band Texas and Charity Hair. Red Sky July have released three albums that all entered the UK country charts in the top three. Karen would become the go-to writer for many pop artists, having written or co-written massive hits for Kylie Minogue, Jamelia, Sugar Babes, Danny Minogue, Will Young, to name but a few. Both sisters recall their time in Alisha's attic with great fondness, often happy to interact and reminisce with fans through social media. Whilst they dismiss the idea of ever reforming or performing, potential future releases of unreleased material has not been ruled out by the pair. Thanks for watching.
Nothing like the two of us, yeah, we understood that loving each other is starting with foundations that we're building to last. Not ready, yeah, you were unsteady, and it's all come to a head.
Shelley is, she's completely moody. She's completely moody. Karen is bossy. She's really bad in the morning, like, totally bad.
I can't be horrible, she's sweet, she's fine.
You're just a bit sort of self-centred sometimes.
Self-centred?
Well, you are sometimes a little bit.
How?
Oh, shush.
That's so strange. That's you.